Okay, so you may be looking for a gimbal camera with pan tilt zoom functionality and you don't want to break the bank at $300 or more for that webcam. Well, the good news is there's a new player in the game that basically lets you have pan tilt zoom functionality with a 4K 30 frames per second or 1080p 60 frames per second capture. It also does automatic tracking like the, for example, the Tiny 2 from OBSBOT or the Insta360 Link, and it's only $179. So today we're going to look at the OBSBOT Tiny 2 LITE PTZ 4K camera just to see how well it does, also how it compares to the original, or I should say the second version of the OBSBOT Tiny 2 and the OG version of the OBSBOT Tiny PTZ 4K camera, and of course the Insta360 Link 4K. So stay around for that and let's go. All right, so the OBSBOT Tiny 2 Lite. So how did it first get to that lower price point? Well, a couple things that are different with this camera versus, say, the OBSBOT Tiny 2 or the Insta360 Link. First off, the sensor size, that's always a big thing in terms of the pricing. So this one has a slightly smaller sensor than the OBSBOT Tiny 2. It has a 1/2-inch sensor, half-inch sensor. And the original OBSBOT Tiny PTZ 4K had a 1/2.8-inch sensor. So that's the big kind of cost savings element. I would say there are other small things. For example, if you look at the packaging, it's a lot smaller. So I kind of knew that something would be different about this camera because I've got basically all the different OBSBOT PTZ cameras, even the Meet 4K, for example. And a lot of their cameras come with these nice hard carry cases that you can use to kind of store them, make sure they don't get scratched up in transport, etc. This one does not have that hard carry case. That's one area where it saved costs. It does, however, have some nice aspects to it, like USB-C at the back of the camera. The wire does terminate to USB-A, but they were thoughtful enough to put a USB-A to USB-C adapter in the box so that you can use it with either terminal type on your computer. Now, the other differences I would say with this camera versus the Tiny 2, for example, is that it has a slightly narrower field of view at 79 degrees or slightly over 79 degrees, whereas the OBSBOT Tiny 2 had an 85.5 degree field of view. So that's a slightly different set of optics. Both of them do support HDR, and I'm happy to report that the HDR in this camera is actually quite functional, whereas in some cameras, when you turn that on, it kind of messes up your background lighting, those types of things, as documented in some of my videos and also some other reviewers' videos as well. So it does also have a pretty good onboard microphone that we'll listen to when we see the default image and also hear the default mic. It can be used in both portrait mode as well as in vertical mode for things like TikTok or YouTube Shorts, for example. And you can even mount it upside down if you want to mount it upside down. This camera, though, the Tiny 2 Lite has a slightly different mount at the bottom of it compared to the Tiny 2, which has a magnetic mount and a separate kind of mounting bracket with the magnet on there. So this one basically has kind of more of a standard mount. It's closer to what the Insta360 Link mount looks like, where it just hinges down and also has a 1/4-20 thread at the bottom. All these cameras you can mount, though, with 1/4-20, so that's nice and convenient as well. And the other big cost savings element probably is that the tracking modes are a bit more limited compared to what you can do with the Tiny 2, which has a ton of amazing tracking capabilities and whiteboard modes and, you know, desk modes. The Tiny 2 Lite does not have that. It has kind of more standard upper body tracking for it. The good news is both of them do have hand gesture control support, so you can zoom in, zoom out, and kind of change the tracking on-off modes with both the Tiny 2 Lite as well as the Tiny 2 itself. So what I want to do now is actually show you what the camera footage looks like and also let you listen to the onboard microphone in the camera. Okay, so the good news is you've already seen the OBSBOT Tiny 2 Lite because I filmed the intro with that. And the only thing I've really changed is I've turned off the bokeh effect or the background blur. That's also, by the way, built into the camera as one of the beauty mode settings that I'll show in a minute.
But the default camera is being used right now. I didn't change any of the settings for exposure or, you know, image tune around the brightness, saturation, all those types of things. I do have a decent lighting setup. I have a key light here, another fill on this side, and I've got a hair light as well. So I've got kind of a three-point lighting system going so to make sure that I'm decently lit. But now you can see what the OBSBOT Tiny 2 light looks like and also hear what the OBSBOT Tiny 2 light sounds like.
Okay, so now that we've kind of seen what the default image looks like from the camera, sorry for tricking you a little bit there because I used it for the intro. Let's have a look at how it does in low light conditions.
Okay, so this is the OBSBOT Tiny 2 light with low light settings. I have nothing firing at my face. My key light and my fill light are both turned off. The only thing I have is overhead lighting, just so you can see what it looks like in low light conditions with its half inch built-in sensor.
Okay, so those are the low light capabilities from the OBSBOT Tiny 2 light. Now, why don't we compare it with the other three two-axis and three-axis gimbal cameras that I mentioned in the intro, the OBSBOT Tiny 2, the Tiny PTZ 4K, as well as the Insta360 Link that has the three-axis gimbal.
All right, so this is the OBSBOT Tiny 2. This is also a slightly tweaked and tuned image from out of the box. I didn't change much, though. Okay, so this is the OBSBOT Tiny 4K, the original.
So the microphone was clipping. I'm just going to record a little soundtrack here, but you can see the two compared.
All right, so you're looking at the Insta360 Link. I've done a few things to tweak the image settings. Looks pretty good, pretty balanced in my case, just for the look that I'm going for. Of course, it's all subjective, so you'll have a different look.
Okay, so what you're seeing here is a quadrant view with the OBSBOT Tiny 2. On the upper left, the OBSBOT Tiny 4K PTZ original upper right, Insta360 Link lower left, and the OBSBOT Tiny 2 Lite lower right.
Okay, so since this is a gimbal camera, I wanted to make sure that I could test out the auto tracking. And no, I'm not going to be sprinting across my room or anything or going like way far back, but I will go kind of side to side just to see how it's tracking me here. And you'll see that, kind of like the other OBSBOT cameras that I like, the tracking is really smooth.
All right, so you control the OBSBOT Tiny 2 Lite and all the OBSBOT webcams through the new OBSBOT Center. One thing that you can see here with the preview, I do have it recording at a lower frame rate and lower resolution because I have so many different recording softwares and screen recordings and things running. But just to quickly go over the software, here's where you would flip it if you want to do vertical mode. Or upside down mounting. You can set it into mirror mode in the settings themselves. You have your different camera options, 4K 30, 1080p 60, 1080p 30, as well as your formats and your bitrate in terms of the camera itself. Then recording, you can do that right from the app here. This is the record button. And you also have the virtual camera. So if you do things like beauty effects or other processing beyond the kind of standard saturation, contrast, brightness controls, or the 90 degree pan tilt zoom controls, which are part of the Windows UVC settings, you're going to want to use the virtual camera with things like OBS or Teams or Zoom in order to see like background blur and those kind of things if you've applied those different filters. And I do have right now background blur or bokeh effect turned on. You can also do a snapshot photo. You can also select your microphone that you want from here if you want to record from the app. I've got too many microphones. Now, the beauty effects, let me just go into that because that's a big differentiator, especially for this application. So here I've got bokeh effect turned on, and I've noticed that in this case, with my computer at least, native works better. Advanced doesn't seem to be working. Even if I change the slider setting, the bokeh effect actually turns off. So now I've got it at about 3. You don't want to typically go to crazy land in terms of like 8, because that doesn't look like a normal camera it could ever look. So 2 or 3 will give you that kind of f1.4, f1.8 looking lens kind of look on an APS-C or full frame camera. But you don't want to go any more than that, I don't think. Otherwise it starts to look a little bit cartoonish. Okay, then you've got the retouch filters, and these are kind of, there's some presets, you can go in one by one. If I put on the man filter, for example, I love the title of that, the man filter, it basically sets different tone and smoothness of skin down, slims my face, which I need, those types of things, and I can turn that back off. You'll notice that it actually consumes a bit of CPU and slows things down. And we've got a few different filters that you can apply if you want to do those filters as well. I like a little bit of bokeh effect just so it looks kind of like a higher-end camera. And you can also set it to the degree that you want it. Now, if I go down the first tab here, normal tracking. So one thing that to note is on the camera, there's a small light. And that's also one of the cost-saving components. The small light that's near the lens of the camera as opposed to the base of the camera. If it's in blue, that means it's tracking. So I'll go ahead and look. And I'm tracking because I can see it's a blue light on the camera. Now, if I put my hand up, and I'm going to show you the hand gestures in a second, it should go to green when I do this. There we go. It's blinking. Now it's static. So now if I move, it's not tracking. And you can see in the GUI on the app, sorry, the graphical user interface, the comments don't like it when I say GUI. Then you can see normal tracking actually got switched off. I can also manually control the gimbal. So for example, I like a little bit less headroom. But one thing I would say, that's probably too little headroom. One thing I would say is that the camera's gotten better in terms of OBSBOT's, you know, general headroom. There used to be, that they'd kind of place you more towards the center of the frame and you look like you're somebody at the kids' table, maybe at a holiday dinner. Now you're kind of back up at the low headroom. You want to usually keep your headroom about as tight to the top of the frame as possible, typically for framing. And of course, you can zoom in manually or zoom out. That is just digital zoom. There is no, moving lens elements or anything for that. So it is going to make things more pixelated if you zoom in. All right. So for image, and one of the reasons why I'm at 1080p 30 right now, well, many reasons, because I've Camtasia recording my screen and everything else in an OBSBOT or an OBS copy open, as well as the OBSBOT app. HDR only works at 30 frames per second, which is pretty common in terms of HDR because they use those extra 30 frames typically to do the calculations for HDR. Focus, the nice thing is it can focus on your face. Well, it tracks your face, it knows where your face is, so it can focus on the face, which is good. And auto exposure also on your face. You can see my auto exposure level is at 1. Normally I have it closer to 0. This actually looks pretty good to me in terms of the exposure. Note that when you do start playing around with the exposure compensation and kind of get the camera warmed up, sometimes you have to move between different values. Typically 0 looks pretty good. When I started the app and I started doing this, it was a little bit too hot. I took it down to -0.3. But it could be a different setting. So this is a nice way to do compensation based on what you're seeing, the time that you're filming or streaming, or if you're on Teams or whatever. These are the normal UVC controls for contrast, saturation, sharpness, and hue. And you know, some of the zoom controls are part of normal UVC. And then when you go into the more settings, that's where you can do kind of some of the more advanced stuff that you wouldn't typically turn on and off often, like sleep timer when you want the device to shut down, being able to use hand gestures. As you saw that I turned on the hand gesture for locking the image. I can also zoom in and out, and how much I zoom at 2x, or I can zoom out. You do want to kind of practice this though before you get in front of a live stream or students or anything, just to make sure that your zoom level is right and that you're good at the hand gestures. There's a bunch of other settings here, but the main ones I've covered that you can do. You can dim the indicator light and turn it off. I'm not a big fan of that because I like to see if it's on and recording, those types of things. And you can set up presets for multiple cameras, and you can also set up presets for, if I go back to console, for where the image is. So if you've got different places where you're filming from, you can preset the gimbal set. So it's a very, very rich set of capabilities that you have through OBSBOT Center. And again, it works on all the different OBSBOT webcams. So I really like how much stuff you can do here with this app. And it really sets it apart from pretty much every other Windows or Win32 client that I've seen in terms of camera controls. All right, so I've been filming the entire video, by the way, on the OBSBOT Tiny 2 Lite, and I gotta say, I'm pretty impressed with the camera. So one of my favorite things about OBSBOT in general with their PTZ auto-tracking cameras is the smoothness and the kind of speed of how it does tracking. It is more human-like. Okay, so would I recommend the OBSBOT Tiny 2 Lite PTZ camera? Yes, I would at its price point. I think they made the right decisions in terms of things to not carry forward, like the hard case or some of the different desk modes, etc., in terms of how the camera is working. So I think it's a great value for money at around $180. Yes, you can probably get some of the other ones refurbished or used perhaps around the same price point. I do really like the OBSBOT Tiny 2 as well as the Insta360 Link as well, but in terms of just straight value, especially if you want to spend under $200 on a camera and you want it to do auto-tracking, smooth auto-tracking. So hopefully you liked this review. Give me a like if you did. Also, subscribe to my channel for more reviews like this, because I've got lots of different camera reviews coming and lots of software reviews. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you soon.